She says we're living in a momentous period, the most momentous period of this earth's history. We see the world corrupted. Satanic agencies have made the earth a stage for horrors, which no language can describe. War and bloodshed are carried on by nations claiming to be Christian. The great conflict now being waged is not merely a strife of man against man. On one side stands the Prince of Life, on the other, the Prince of Darkness. There are only two sides. And she says, on which side are you? Lord, have mercy. These are exciting times. These are frightening times. But these are also thrilling times because all of us know something is about to happen. Amen? Amen? And that's why Jeannie and I are so delighted to be here this special weekend with our nephew Matthew and his family. My brother Eugene is also here from Carolina with his wife. And we are passing through from Phoenix, Arizona, and glad to be out of the heat, which is going to be 115 this week. But you're having your own share of heat too. Thank you for the opportunity of standing before you and sharing God's word. I'm going to show some things on the screen and also hopefully some things that will be of interest to the children. I'm Lonnie Melashenko, and those who have joined us online, I know a number of you have, and some of you have come just because you heard that we were going to be here today. I'm so delighted to be at the Pendleton Church. I've never been here in my life, I don't think. And I am delighted to know that you are such a powerful presence that my nephew would bring his children and their family and drive over an hour on Sabbath to get here on Sabbath morning. Amen. So praise to the saints of Pendleton. Thank you. And thank you, Matthew, for leading us out in such beautiful music this morning. Mid-December, cold, 1903, exactly 120 years ago, two brothers ran excitedly into the telegraph operator's office. Operator, operator, please, would you send a text message back to our father who lives in Dayton, Ohio? Jeannie and I have just moved from Dayton, Ohio. We've been living there for 10 years. Well, the telegraph operator said, yes, I can type out a message. It starts out, Kitty Hawk, what would you like me to say? I've read this in the Smithsonian. I've seen the actual telex. Success! Four flights on Thursday morning, all against 21 mile per hour winds, started at ground level with engine power alone. Average speed through the air, 31 miles per hour. Longest flight, 59 seconds. Inform press, home for Christmas, signed Orville and Wilbur. And they misspelled Orville's name, I saw that. Well, the message got back to Dayton, Ohio, where I lived with Jeannie, and it was received by their father, Bishop Wright, who was a minister in that town. He read that message. He got so excited, he ran down to the local newspaper office, and I was a subscriber to the Dayton Daily News, and he slammed that message on the editor's desk, and he said, can you print this? And the editor read the message, and, well, he was kind of excited, and he said, I sure can. And the next morning, this is the actual headlines that came out in the Dayton Daily News. Popular local bicycle merchants to be home for the holidays. Totally missed the message! Totally missed the message! The Bible says that all of us are messengers. Ye are my witnesses, Jesus said. You, one person, are the light of the world. You are the bread of life. Could it be, and I'm just asking a question here in Pendleton, could it be, with all of our prosperity in America, with all of our opportunities and all of our technologies, all of the satellite uplinks and downlinks and live website and chat room Bible studies, all the digital towers, all of the Zoom things we've done this last couple of years with the COVID, with our cable TV, our video and our audios, could it be, I'm just asking the question, Could it be that we, of all people, are in danger of missing the message? What is our message? Somebody, what is our message?
Tell others about Jesus.
Elder H.M.S. Richards, I followed in his footsteps there after his son Harold passed away. Voice Prophecy is going to be celebrating nearly 100 years coming up here in a couple of years. He used to go to camp meetings. He loved to go to the Oregon Conference. He loved to go to Washington Conference, great big one in Gladstone. And the brethren would come up and the little ladies would, "Brother Richards, what's the message? We hear that some of those women in Southern California are wearing lipstick and they're even putting on some rouge. What's the message, Brother Richards?" You know what his famous answer for that was? "Well, if the barn needs painting, paint it." He was a little bit ahead of his time, wasn't he? But when he was asked the question, what is our message? What is our message? It ought to be so crystal clear that nobody misses it. His answer was always one word. Our message is Jesus. And if he added another word, he would say, Jesus only. I don't see too many African Americans in this congregation. Do we have any? Well, I grew up in a black church. My father was ordained in a black church. Jeannie and I went to a series of meetings at the Berean Church in Southern California, where Little Richard came. You white people haven't a clue who Little Richard is. He would sit behind me and say, "Amen." He'd bring his eight bodyguards in his great big white stretch limousine. "Preach it, brother." In a black church, the walls talk back as you're preaching. I want to hear some amens this morning. In fact, Ellen White says, if we don't respond in the worship service, we're actually giving glory and praise to another force that's also present. Because Jesus deserves the response. He wants us to say amen. He wants us to stand up and say hallelujah, praise the Lord. And if you don't do that, you're actually, she says, you're worshiping another power. That's pretty serious stuff. I've been reading her writings during COVID. So let's have a little prayer as we begin this morning. Father, it's not enough to study the Bible as other books are studied. In order for it to be understood savingly this morning, Lord, the Holy Spirit must be here and move upon our hearts as we search so that we do something after we study. And prayer is just the rustling of the wings of the angels that are on their way, bringing us the boons of heaven. So may we just now see and hear the angel in our church here this morning as the chariot wheels rumble in prayer. We pray in Jesus' name. And the church said together,
amen.
Amen. Back in 1844, almost 188 years, when William Miller was busy preaching there in the East Coast, all across New England, one out of 17 Americans were Millerites. Did you know that? That message of William Miller shook the world. But as he was preaching about Jesus coming soon in October, something else happened on May 24, 1844. A gentleman by the name of Samuel F.B. Morse, who invented the Morse code. How many of you with me are ham radio operators? KC6SNM, that's me. He invented Morse code, and of course the military has used that, and Samuel Morse opened the very first U.S. telegraph line in 1844 between Baltimore and Washington, D.C., and from the U.S. Capitol building, Morse sent to Baltimore the very first officially telegraphed words ever said, "What hath God wrought?" And opened our telecommunications age. What hath God wrought? What hath God wrought? What does it all mean here in America? And Canada, and all over the planet. What hath God wrought when one germ, one virus, one coronavirus in 1 week shut down airlines, closed international barriers, airports, closed churches, hospitals, Wall Street, the state of New York. What does it all mean? We're finally coming back, but many people aren't going back to church yet. A lot of people are just watching online because they're not sure they should come yet. COVID-19, something was a disease that caused economic meltdown, social distancing, fines. I have a doctor friend at Loma Linda University. If you were caught walking outside of Loma Linda in the streets of San Bernardino without a mask, you were fined $5,000. This is how serious it was. This is not something we're just, this is not a Hollywood show. This really happened. You were fined for going to the beach in America. What hath God wrought? I want you to take that Bible in the pew in front of you. I hope you bring your Bibles. I'm an old-fashioned preacher. I like to use scriptures. I want you to turn to just one text with me this morning. It's in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 19 to 21. I'll come to that in a moment. 2 Peter, that's toward the end of the Bible, chapter 1. Because the Apostle Peter here makes some profound statements with huge implications for people today who are facing fear. Now, I appreciate so much that principal and the teacher of your school here, because our young people have been permanently damaged by not going to school for 2.5 years. And we now have the highest spike ever in the history of planet of suicide among young people. Fear. Pandemic. Peter himself experienced cataclysmic calamities and colossal pandemics in his life. Remember this big fisherman? All the Niagaras of failures that he had in his life. Yet, incredibly, Peter was the only person ever in the history of this planet to walk on water. What hath God wrought? Is there a vaccine here this morning? Listen, Peter deals with this question for us. If we're facing calamity, disaster, if we've had some sort of economic meltdown, fear of jobs lost, health, funerals during the pandemic, I could not go and conduct funerals. I just came back from conducting this week with Jeannie in Paradise, California, a funeral for one of my church members because the state of California said, if you gather together, you're going to be put in jail. So I had to hold the funeral just last week, 2 years later. Fear. No food, no income, insecurity. Peter asks that question, what does all this mean? He says, oh, I know. I saw the miracles. I was there with the feeding of the 5,000. Yes, I walked on water. I even saw Moses. I saw Elijah. But listen up, folks here. Listen up, America. Reeling under all kinds of race riots and carnage. Peter says, listen, in 2023 and 2024, as we're getting ready to see more things melt down in our political scenes than we've ever seen on this planet, Peter says, God is not caught up short. Nope. He says, this is now God's finest hour. Can I hear an amen? Amen. And your finest hour, because he says in chapter 1, 1 Peter, verses 19, Lonnie, here's why it's good news this morning. We have also a more sure word of what? Prophecy. Whereunto, Lonnie, you do well that ye take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star, who's that day star? Jesus, arise in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scriptures of any private interpretation, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved upon by the Holy Ghost. Folks, do you remember? Think back 2 years ago. In just 1 week, planet Earth plunged into darkness. We called it pandemic. A dark, dark place. Peter's talking about this dark place, the curtain of death. You know, in the Dark Ages, all of those rites and ceremonies and things that corrupted the church took centuries to take place until finally there was spiritual darkness in the Dark Ages. And that took centuries. But this darkness took place in 1 week. Never, ever anything like that. Science fiction couldn't have come up with something like that. Hollywood. So Peter says, listen up. I want you to pay attention that ye take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. And listen, folks, it is dark out there. Our world, our nation, our city, our neighborhoods, our homes, we are now in a very, very dark, dark place. Like never before in history. And the spirit of prophecy just told us this morning, we are now today at the end of time living in the dark, dark night of sin. And if you think things are going to get better because you get on the right political bandwagon in this next election coming up, think again, folks. Oh, yes, many neon lights and Hollywood lights and Las Vegas lights are gleaming, the Great White Way and Times Square, Tinseltown, Boardwalk, but few of them can mark the way to light. We live in a culture, according to Time Magazine and Newsweek, I don't care who you are, I don't care which political side you're on, we live in a culture today of liars. And they're always trying to weigh what is truth. It's all lies. Everybody's lying. Darkness. And God's word tells us that it's there, the combustion of noxious gases rising from the miasma of pestilential morasses, which leads hapless wanderers into sloughs of despond and suicide and fear and terror. They leave millions today in total darkness, perishing in nursing homes, hungry, homeless, hopeless, not just wandering the streets, and I see them right over here in your communities too, holding out little, I'm hungry, feed me, I'm homeless. Open your eyes, folks, listen. Myriads are now wandering in mazes of doubt and skepticism, error and total political uncertainty, so much so that America is truly in a meltdown. And great controversy talked about this, and we often wondered, how is this all going to happen? How could it possibly take place? I want you to see something on the screen. This is actually happening now, not only in Norway. This has been happening in California and some places here in the Northwest. We used to talk about how are there going to be no money? You won't be able to buy or sell. Watch the screen. Get the sound up on that, too.
4 years ago, we started to wonder, what would shopping look like if you could walk into a store, grab what you want, and just go? What if we could weave the most advanced machine learning, computer vision, and AI into the very fabric of a store so you never have to wait in line? No lines, no checkouts, no registers. Welcome to Amazon Go. Use the Amazon Go app to enter. Then put away your phone and start shopping. It's really that simple. Take whatever you like. Anything you pick up is automatically added to your virtual cart. If you change your mind about that cupcake, just put it back. Our technology will update your virtual cart automatically. So, how does it work? We use computer vision, deep learning algorithms, and sensor fusion, much like you find in self-driving cars. We call it Just Walk Out technology. Once you've got everything you want, you can just go. When you leave, our Just Walk Out technology adds up your virtual cart and charges your Amazon account. Your receipt is sent straight to the app, and you can keep going. Amazon Go. No lines, no checkout. No, seriously.
Now, I'm not going to get into politics here, but look at the next slide at who is really behind this. We need to put on our seatbelts because something is happening so fast. President Obama said, our culture in the next few years is going to totally so much change, it will take your breath away. It will take your money away. So now the big question, pandemic, coronavirus, and some think Bill Gates got this all going and so forth, and who knows what the truth is. Who's the cause of all this? Is it China? A laboratory over there in Wuhan? Listen, there's a very, very significant statement from a third grader who never finished school in Portland, Maine. Remember back in Matthew chapter 24, Jesus used a unique New Testament word telling about end-time last-day prophecies that are going to take place today. And it's a word rarely used in Scripture, even more scarcely used today in modern times because it is so rare. Jesus predicted in verses 6 and 7 of Matthew 24, Lonnie, you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you're not troubled, for all these things must come to pass. But the end is not yet. For nations will rise against nations, kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines. What's the next word? Pestilences and earthquakes in various places. All these things are the beginning of sorrows. But that word, pestilences, you go home and look it up in your dictionary. Merriam-Webster says, a pestilence is any contagious or infectious epidemic disease that is virulent and devastating. Specifically, he mentions the bubonic plague. But wow, because that word virulent means this is a virus with no cure. And the specialists are now telling us that something's coming up again with this same virus that's resurfacing in Australia that could come and wipe out the earth this fall. Listen. Now from a little third grade girl of education in New England, writing this in the book Great Controversy, page 589, 590, about this word pestilence. She says about Satan. While appearing to the children of men as a great physician who can heal all their maladies, Satan will bring disease and disaster until populous cities are reduced to ruin and desolation. Even now, he is at work in accidents and calamities by sea and by land, in great conflagrations, in fierce tornadoes, terrific hailstorms, in tempests, floods, cyclones, tidal waves, and earthquakes. In every place and in a thousand forms, Satan is exercising his power. He sweeps away the ripening harvest, and famine and distress follow. Now listen to the next sentence. He imparts to the air a deadly taint, and thousands perish by the pestilence. These visitations are to become more and more frequent and disastrous. Destruction will be upon both man and beast, and now the scientists are telling that your animals, your pets, can get virus and die of COVID-19. I ask again the question, what hath God wrought? What does all this mean? 1 Peter 1, 19 to 21 says, ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. There's good news, folks. There's going to be light. Can I hear an amen? The day star can arise in your heart, even if you're watching online this morning. Listen up, blessed be God. He has given us the sure light that shines in a long, dark place, and right here is that light of lights. I know they're trying to get rid of it in the Bible, in the libraries, in the public schools. But this book is the sure light that shines in a dark place. It illumines the path of life clear to the end, even in the face of COVID-19 or whatever else is coming from Australia this fall. So you and I today can go home and we can test God. Does God ever lie? Then you can claim his promises here. That same Holy Spirit who inspired this prophecy, the same Holy Spirit who helped create the world, the same power that Jesus promised is available to you. And one-third of this book is prophecy. That means it's a guiding light for the future of America, for Canada, for Mexico, for the world. Amen? What hath God wrought? What does all of this that's been happening here in the last 2.5 years mean? Race and violence in America's major cities, carnage by evil and paid hoodlums. Listen, friend, Peter says it means simply, we have the more sure word that we can count on today. Right here. Whereunto ye do well that ye take heed. Can you hear Peter? Hey, he says, folks, time to take God's word seriously. It's time to get back to the book, back to the Bible. Prayer time, worship time, study time. That leads me to one more scripture. Acts chapter 17, verse 11. You remember that Paul says that the Bereans that he visited were more noble than the Thessalonians because they did something. They did what? They studied. They opened the Bible. They read it regularly. You know, there are some good things that are happening on our planet, even though so much evil is happening, and so many opportunities are possible for you, even though you say, well, I never got finished with college, I never even got finished with high school, I've got all kinds of disabilities. Listen, I want you to watch the screen again. Watch this lady, and watch the children and how they're helping mom, but notice she has no arms, she has no abilities. Watch carefully. and you thought you didn't have any talents. There is no excuse. She read the quotation. There's no limit to the usefulness of one who, putting self aside, makes room for the working of the Holy Spirit on their hearts and lives a life dedicated to the Lord. I promise you, if you pray the prayer every morning, Lord, I don't know who you're going to have me meet. I don't know what you want me to do. If you pray that prayer sincerely, you will be blown away by the doors of opportunity that open to you just by breathing that prayer, because you are Jesus Christ to the people on your street. You did not come into this world here by accident. You are here by divine appointment. And this last scripture says, the Bereans were more noble than the Thessalonians because they searched the scriptures. How often did they do that? I am so impressed. I get choked up. Jeannie and I, we sit in the back room of Matthew's family as they have family worship every night. The children have an opportunity to share some things, some highlights, lowlights. They're studying the Bible, the book of Samuel right now. Daily study. Now, I want you to put on your seatbelts because I'm going to share something rather shocking to Seventh-day Adventists. If you're not a Seventh-day Adventist, you can relax. But you know, we have the political pollsters, the Gallup poll, the Lou Harris poll, you have the Reuters and so forth. Well, does anybody here know what the religious pollsters are for the religious trends? What is the name of the person who does the religious trend polls? Barna, George Barna, Barna Research. I don't always like what George Barna comes up and says that are the actual facts, but he's usually right. And he said, I've got several of his books, he said the Seventh-day Adventists used to be known as the people of the book. You didn't want to get in argument with an Adventist, he said. They'll always beat you, hands down. They know this book backwards and forwards in debates. They read this book daily. But you know what he says now? And I weep. That's not true of Adventists anymore. At least 14 other denominations read the Bible more than we do daily. That ought to be a stinger to us. Acts 17 says, they searched the scriptures daily. Now, there's a doctor in St. Helena, California, that adds to this something else. Dr. Arlene Taylor, some of you might want to look up her website. She's a brain specialist, and she works with the brain surgeon and the brain specialist of all denominations, and no, particularly the atheistic ones that have no particular background, because they're studying something in the medical world. You know, everything is done by scientific experiment. They will take placebos. You know what a placebo is? You have a real pill and then one that's not the real thing, it's got something else in it, and they'll do laboratory tests to see which ones seem to work the best. Well, everything in the medical world is based on evidence in the laboratory. But now the doctors, and especially the psychiatrists and the brain specialists, are studying prayer, because doctors and physicians and surgeons know that when the rabbi comes in and has a little blessing for his patient before he goes into surgery, or the priest, or the imam, or the minister, or the chaplain, when they come in and have prayer with the patient always seems to do better. How do you test that in a laboratory? They've been doing that. You know, Ellen White says something very interesting about prayer. When you pray, she says, electrical impulse is emitted from the brain. And I believe that God has a big cosmic sensor. He gets that impulse, and he can send messages back to us the same way to our brain. But scientists, hold on to your seats, have now taken electrodes, and they've put those on your brain. When you pray and think a prayer for a friend that's in a hospital, maybe in a surgical room in Orlando, Florida, hold on to your seats. Doctors and science has now proven, they put electrodes and those same on that patient in Florida. When you think a prayer for that person, something happens in the brain of that person you're praying for. Prayer works. They don't understand it. Scientists are blown away. This is something that they can't test in the medical labs. We used to be known as people who worshiped the book, the Bible. We studied it, and we prayed. And then this doctor has discovered something else with all of these scientists. Put on your seatbelts, you're not going to believe this. That when you pray, these scientists now, who are not necessarily spiritual people, their blind studies have shown that prayer not only has power, but it changes brain cells with the different kinds of prayers that you pray. If you pray a positive prayer that has got full of praise, it does something especially praise, does brain activity. And so they have been discovering, and they have come out with things. You go on her website, and you'll see what she says, Dr. Arlene Taylor. They have discovered when you read something spiritual, you know, a devotional book can be a Bible, or you're reading something, but you have to read it out loud for 12 minutes every single day. Are you ready for this? You're not going to believe this. You can actually reverse dementia. And they're wondering if this might be a clue to Alzheimer's. You got to read it out loud every day for 12 minutes. That's why Jeannie and I are now reading through the Conflict of the Ages series. And last year, you know, when the year, first year before the COVID hit, we started reading through the five volumes of the Conflict of the Ages out loud. Jeannie would read a page, she'd hand the book to me, I'd read a page out loud. We'd do that for about, well, 12 minutes each, 24 minutes. That's our devotional every night. Within 1 year, we got through all five volumes of the Great Controversy, of the Conflict of the Ages, out loud. I don't want to have to go to an Alzheimer's unit. But listen, Peter, the apostle, is his message this morning. Folks, let's get back to the book. Let's get back to reading it. How about reading it out loud? You can do it over the phone with a friend. If you live at home and you're single, call somebody and take turns every night reading it out loud. And let's get back to praying. Ellen White says something else. She says, we are only using, you saw this woman, the talents that she has. She says, we only use 1/3 of our talents. If we use 1/3 of what our talents enable us to do, with the other 2/3 of our powers, we are working against Christ and we're working for the devil. That's an amazing statement. What hath God wrought? COVID-19 is a unique time in history, and it's a unique invitation, a unique opportunity, not just for America. It's a time for the world to sit up. And Peter says to take notice, time for you to take heed. Time for the right perspectives. And maybe honest for a last minute before we close. We've had Dr. Tony Fauci and Dr. Deborah Birx and political right, political left. You got different people in the White House and they're trying to explain what's been going on in explosive politics on the right and the left. You don't know whether it's CNN or is it Fox News. It's hard to deceive. What's a real threat and what's just simple panic and headline hysteria, right? Having right perspective is good, but using perspective is better. And Peter reminds us, listen up, this is the book that gives us the right perspective. Because the final movements will be rapid ones, and the spirit of prophecy said, therefore we need to press together, press together, press together. These are exciting times, they're frightening times, they're thrilling times, because all of us know something is about to happen. My dear dad died about 10 years ago this summer when I was speaking at a camp meeting in southern New England. I got a phone call, your dad died, and I had to finish my camp meeting series. Before he passed away, the Voice of Prophecy had put together a lot of musicals. Some of you watched those family reunion musicals Saturday night on the Hope Channel. Dad talks about the fact that He's growing older, and one of these days, he's going to pass away. Notice my hair is turning white. People come up to me after church, and they will come up to me today and say, I watch you on Voice of Prophecies, evangelistic campaigns, and but you don't have gray hair. Well, here we are. But I want to go home, don't you? This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. I want you to watch, and may this be your prayer as my dad sings this song, Lead Me Gently Home. Watch the screen.
Thank you.
Would you stand with me as we pray? Lord, Peter speaks with authority here this morning. Lon, Pendleton, whoever's watching online, please don't miss the message. Scripture is profoundly important for us in 2023, and because it's the voice of God speaking to our soul, stirring, pleading. Startling supernatural times are before us, and it is fatal to be careless or indifferent. Scripture says, yet a little while, and he that shall come, and will not tarry. Lord, we cannot afford to be disobedient to God's invitation he's giving us this morning. If we refuse, we'll have no probation. Choose ye this day whom ye will serve, God or mammon, right now. While it's still today, help us respond out loud. And I'd like to have you say these words, if that's your prayer. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Would you say that? As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Help us not to miss the message. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.